Ah, yeah, okay. To thank the organizers and especially Professor Kouvanis, and it's really a great pleasure for me to be again in Greece to the excellent Panhellenic Congress on Epilepsy. And I will try to present to you some of the most important data present on the early epileptic encephalopathies, their genetic background and phenotypic spectrum, also some of my experience in this topic. As you all know, the epileptic encephalopathies are conditions in which we presume that epileptic activity may contribute to the severe cognitive and behavioral disturbances, which are beyond and above what we expect usually from the underlying pathology. And usually these impairments aggravate and worsen over time. And this is due, or we suppose that this is due to the epilepsy and epileptiform activity. According to ILA classification, or some of them are not already included in the classification and proposals, there are main 9 syndromes of epileptic encephalopathy, and the first 5 are listed as early onset epileptic encephalopathies. About the genetic background, 2012, a nice review appeared in Pediatric Neurology, and the Italian colleagues, the authors, they listed 11 syndromes under the term early onset epileptic encephalopathies. In the same year, in the European Journal of Medical Genetics, you can see that already 14 disorders are listed as early infantile epileptic encephalopathies. And a week ago, when I searched OMIM for these epileptic encephalopathies and looking at the first one, you can see I found that there are already 25 diseases with the red arrow. So during these 2 years, the number of these diseases doubled. So we have increased information on the genetic background and these very severe early disorders. And this is on the blog of ILA Genetic Commission. So you can see the progress in the last 10 years, especially in the last 5 to 2 years, with a lot of publication on the major genes associated in the early epileptic encephalopathies, of course, with the SCN1 mutation, the major gene, and also some new one appearing just in the last 1 or 2 years. So there are 19 conditions listed there, but already 25 published in the online Mendelian Inheritance of Men. This is the slide I received from my friend Sarah Weghuizen. She presented a nice paper on the Stockholm Congress with a topic on the huge genetic heterogeneity in this condition, with some of the channels which are implicated marked in black, and the other genes are encoding proteins or some signals transducers in the brain. So this is really a heterogeneous conditions also in the turf of genetic background. Of course, it's difficult to categorize all this syndrome, and in a clinical review from 2012, the authors state that there are many, but most of them can be divided into 3 main categories: Dravet syndrome, Ohtahara, and West syndrome. These are the epileptic encephalopathy with very early onset. We know about Ohtahara syndrome. It's affecting neonates, usually in the first 2 weeks of life, with prominent tonic spasms, also focal seizures, and much more rarely myoclonic seizures. The developmental delay is severe, and mostly males are affected. And the EEG shows this typical pattern of birth suppression. But when we look, for example, at this 2012 review by Italian colleagues, at least 6 genes are listed as implicated in the genetic cause of these disorders, with probably the syntaxin-binding protein, the second one, very often causing this disorder. Of course, there are much more genes appearing in the last 2 years and causative for this disorder. So again, genetic heterogeneity for only one disorder with Ohtahara. The first one listed in the OMIM is the among the epileptic encephalopathy is related to a IREX gene located in the region, this region of the X chromosome, and causing 3 main phenotypes. Probably the most common is the X-linked infantile spasm, and this was shown in the paper of Shotbridge from 2010, studying almost approximately 100 families, where the X-linked West syndrome was shown to be present in 12 families. And these authors point that there is a striking intra and interfamiliar pleiotropy, but also genetic heterogeneity. This is the hallmark of this disorder, IREX-related early onset encephalopathies. So this is again a difficult task to find a person who carried this mutation and to prove it. But there are some clues, and it's interesting that already in 2006, a Japanese colleague proposed a paradigm for West syndrome and infantile spasm, because quite often we found in IRX disorder such such a phenotype of West syndrome. IRX play a pivot role not only in the development of interneurons, so it could be said that West syndrome or the spasms are interneuronopathy, because they are lacking in IRX-related lissencephaly and very much disturbed, abnormal in other mutation related to this gene. The second early onset epileptic encephalopathy is again associated with mutation in a gene on X chromosome in the same region, the CDKL5 gene, first described more than 10 years ago already, with two mutations in a patient, girls with atypical Rett syndrome. In the same time, same authors described that the pathways, the expressions of CDKL5 overlaps with MECP2, the major gene in Rett syndrome. So these are genes with common pathway. But 10 years already later, we know that this disorder has unique characteristic, is independent clinical entity, and is listed as this second type of early onset encephalopathies. Usually the patient have a severe developmental delay already from the birth. The seizure onset is early. There are subtle dysmorphic or non-dysmorphic feature and very prominent seizure and sleep disturbance and disturbances in comparison to the classical Rett related to MECP2. So there is probably a distinct clinical profile, and these subtle facial and lip abnormalities may assist us in finding patient suffering from CDKL5 disorder. These are the pictures published by last paper with some common feature in these girls suffering from CDKL5 disorder, affecting the face, but also the limbs. And very important is, and this is published by a French group, Nadia Bay-Buisson group in 2008, that there are clinical features in terms of epilepsy which can help us to differentiate this disorder. First stage of the epilepsy is the early onset within the first 10 weeks, but with normal EEG, despite frequent convulsive seizures. Then the patient developed epileptic encephalopathy with hips arrhythmia and spasm. And the later stage is characterized by absence of seizure in some of the patients, but also some, or probably majority of them, suffering refractory epilepsy with polymorphic seizure type. So the early onset seizures with normal EEG and severe hypotonia probably is the key clinical point to identify girls with CDKL5. Because MRI is not specific, it shows some changes as cerebellar atrophy, global atrophy with some hypointensity and hypoplastic anteromesial part of the temporal lobe with delayed myelination in the posterior part of the brain, periventricular, but this is really non-specific. And really the course is specific, and we should look even in males, which are much rarely found to bear this mutation, but they are much more severely affected. All of them suffer severe epilepsy with very early onset. They have a profound intellectual delay, and they have no eye fixation and pursuit, no hand skills, and infantile spasm present in all of this patient. And I will present a case. Actually, the first case we proved to have this type of mutation now is 3.5 years old with early seizure onset, described as tonic with some version and focal sign. And some of these seizures were followed with something which resembled subtle spasms. They presented in sirens during sleep, and from the age of 1 year, the parents noted, but probably it was earlier, a severe decline in the psychomotor development. The girls still suffer severe and spasms, which were not controlled by all the drugs we tried, probably only with ACTH, but temporarily, and insufficient effect, but then the seizure relapsed. We even tried with Thanasi Evangeliou ketogenic diet. And this is the MR of this patient. We did it in 2012. Nothing specific, of course, atrophy, especially in the temporal part with delayed myelination, but nothing we could pick. And these are the facial appearance of this girl. There is a resemblance to the picture I showed you. At that time, I didn't make a photo of the hand of the foot. So there are subtle dysmorphic features. And this is the first EEG I did in May 2012. Not so bad. Of course, I'm asymmetry and mostly on the left and in the temporal region. This is 1 month later, becoming worse. And this is in July with a typical and severe hypsarrhythmic pattern. And this is in September. We recorded many times seizures, showing also this very subtle, not only on EEG, but in a severe hypotonic child, spasms. And I will try now to show it, oops, a video of this patient. Severely hypotonic, no hand skills, no eye pursuit with subtle spasm, and no head control even now. With some effect from the ketogenic diet, but then relapse of the seizures. So we found this by targeting CDKL5 sequencing, a mutation in exon 7. It's not a new one. It's published already 2006. The EEG I did in June this year is again very, very bad, and the situation is really dramatic and catastrophic for the family. But this is demonstrating that this is very, very severe encephalopathy in some cases, because this is the second patient I have in the same age with early onset seizure in the second month, described as chronic generalized cyanosis and some lateralization on the right, appearing in sleep, and the increasing frequency. Also, some episode during bath or washing appeared, and one episode even with right postictal hemiparesis was described. Then long spasm series, mostly aftonic spasm appeared during sleep, or only seizures with eye opening, some flush and forced breathing. Initially, there were no hypsarrhythmia at EEG and no effect from the anti-epileptic drugs. She even worsened under ACTH treatment, and spasm in sleep continued. Now she has only one seizure per week. MRI was nothing special. Twice we did it, some delayed myelination and very mild atrophy. In the meantime, we sent DNA for whole exome sequencing to a study named Euroepinomics. And because of the parent wish and some ictal features, we did many, many ictal VDEG, even discussed presurgical ovulation, which was not, of course, feasible because PET was normal and nothing was present on MR. And this is the seizure type we recorded many times from May 2012 to May 2013. You see there are some fast activity on the left frontal with more prominent spikes and spike wave activity on the left, and probably responsible for this asymmetric appearance of the seizures with asymmetric tonic posture at the beginning and prominent, as you will see later, head and mostly eye version to the right. And then after this initial presentation, this spasm with asymmetric feature appear and can last up to 20 minutes. So this is the usual EEG, which is also now like that. But in October 2013, when we had discussed presurgical evaluation, I received a call from Sarah Weghuizen that they found by whole exome sequencing CDKL5 mutation, and we confirmed it by gene sequencing in Bulgaria. But this is the mutation, as you see, the mother and the patient with this splice site mutation, and also the father gene and the finding in the girl. But in this case, the psychomotor delay is not so severe. The crawling and sitting started at age 9. At 11 months, she could walk with some support, with some limping of the right leg. Now she walks independently and even can run, speak only 3 to 4 words dysarthric and very rarely, but the receptive leg is not so bad, even normal. There are no stereotypies. And this is the last EEG I did 2 weeks ago with quite normal finding, or not so abnormal. So there is really also phenotypic heterogeneity in this unique and identified already disorder. A very interesting and quite new entity is the 9th type of early onset epileptic encephalopathy, again with Hicks-linked inheritance, the PCDH19 gene, described first by Dibben in families with epilepsy with mental retardation, and then studied by French group Christelle Depien in Dravet-like syndrome, in Dravet-like patient, girls who were SCN1A negative. They found 11 girls who were positive for the mutation, and most of these mutations were present in the first exon of the gene, who is very important and much implicated in the function of the protein. And this protein is part of the delta protocadherins and responsive and very important for the intercellular adhesion and neuronal connection. This is a unique disorder because of the paradoxical X inheritance, because the normal individual, they have only positive cells and they function normally. The mutated male, they have only negative cells, so the adhesion is not disturbed and the signaling between cells is normal. But in mosaic males with mutation and the mutated female, depending on the mosaicism and the X inactivation properties, there is mental retardation only in females usually, or epilepsy with mental retardation in males. There is some overlap with the classical Dravet syndrome because the seizures are usually febrile at the beginning, some afebrile, but they appear very characteristic in clusters. There is developmental speech delay in A, and the behavioral disturbances are most common in the form of autism. Rarely, we can observe myoclonic and atypical absence seizures, but more frequently, the persisting seizures are in the form of focal seizure, which predominate. The mutation can be found de novo in sporadic cases or within the setting of a family with EFMR. The screening in symptomatic females with encephalopathic course and similar epilepsy can give approximately 10% mutation rate. And this is the paper from Renzo Ghirini's group and Carlo Marini describing electroclinical pattern of focal seizures in these girls, predominantly involving the frontotemporal limbic system, where the epileptogenic dysfunction is mostly found. So this is characteristic for this disorder. Of course, there are many papers which appeared in the last year, and this is the last one in neurogenetics, again from the group when Sarah Weckhuizen is working. So they describe this heterogeneity, variable expression, even within families because of this X inactivation, the influence probably of some genetic modifier, and the very frequently observed mosaicism of the mutation, not only peripheral, but also in the blood. So it's difficult to predict the course within family for unborn babies or even for the affected. And this is a case we described starting at the age of 5 months with febrile seizures in cluster lasting from 2 to 4 days, described as tonic or tonic-clonic seizures without effect from the many of the drugs and with some delay, mostly in the language area, starting to speak about the age of 3 years. Then at the age of 6, febrile seizures appeared, but the seizure-free intervals increased up to 6 months when we added levetiracetam to valproate. So now she has only twice a year seizures in cluster lasting 1 to 2 days. And of course, there is a deficit in the verbal and performance IQ. The behavior is severely disturbed, autistic, with marked autoaggressive outburst. EEG is slightly asymmetric, but slow background, and neuroimaging is normally. And this is just a scan of a EEG from a tonic-clonic asymmetric seizure in this girl. And this is a patient where we found a mutation in exon 5, which is not so common because the usual mutation are in exon 1. A mutation which was found, this is the second case, which is inherited from unaffected, absolutely normal mother with normal IQ. So it's quite unusual but possible to have a mother with mutation which transmitted to the girl which is symptomatic. Another girl with normal pregnancy delivery, negative history, and early onset of tonic spasm in a very long series, very severe. The EEG was described initially, I didn't see it as vibration burst, but then I saw hips arrhythmia, ACTH without effect and very severe side effects, so parents decided to go to Vienna. She was admitted there and without control from diazepam, midazolam, etc., but pyridoxine trial stopped almost immediately the seizure. So again, we have to check in this case all the features of eventual pyridoxine dependent epilepsy. She was negative for the gene mutation. All the other metabolics results were normal. But then we continued to use pyridoxine for 6 months while she was seizure-free and still seizure-free, very, very profound delay. Almost no head control, severe hypotonia, no eye contact, no language, and MRI is nothing specific but delayed myelination and mild atrophy. And again, I sent DNA for whole exome sequencing, and in this paper, which appeared now in this month in American Journal of Human Genetics, this is one of the two patients harboring a mutation in this gene, GNNA1A, a missense mutation, but the course is quite different from the second patient who continues to have seizure, and but who is also very severely cognitively delayed. The first paper on this gene appeared last September. A Japanese group found four mutations in this gene and described a pattern of severe epileptic encephalopathy in some epilepsy also related to movement disorder. And in their patient, three of these cases suffered from Otahara syndrome. As you can see, the seizures persist, they are intractable, and the delay is very severe because only one patient has head control. All the others, as also my patient and the other described already six in the literature, a very, very, very profound psychomotor delay. So this is a new type of epileptic encephalopathy. And the last case I would like to present is retarded already from the beginning with lacking head control and late sitting, standing, a tactic gait or also in the moment, with language started to develop at the age of three with still ataxic and dysarthric, seizure onset with hypomotor, buzz-related generalized seizure at the age of six, then generalized tonic-clonic seizure, again after bath or in sleep, with some posterior abnormalities on EEG and normal CT. Then they described also myoclonic and atonic seizure, and in this case we could suspect SCN1A mutation or Dravet borderline picture. MRI showed mild brain atrophy, but the child is disturbed because it's hypotonic with ataxia, pyramidal signs. And video EEG, for the first time I recorded a seizure, showed a left frontal onset and hemiclonic development. Then the seizure persists in long cluster, as described by parents, asymmetric sometimes or provoked by tactile stimuli. They went to Turkey and they were examined there by metabolic specialist. The EEG was described as slow, and they tried ketogenic diet. Again, Tanasis know about this, and there is some improvement. So this chart has to be proved to be SCN1 negative, has no mutation in the GLUT1A DC gene. So again, we sent for whole exome sequencing. In the last October, I recorded six seizures starting from the right, but also from the left, frontotemporal, heavy asymmetric tonic onset, and then lateralizing generalized tonic-clonic seizure with this ping-pong phenomenon of ductal activity from right to left. And this is the seizure of this boy. They are very dramatic for the family, and only during these clusters, the parent described as the child stopped to walk, stopped to speech. So this is really seizure-related, but very, very severe. So of course they also wanted to do presurgical evaluation because the condition is uncontrolled by drugs, but with this seizure coming from two sides of the brain, it's impossible to think about this. We decided not to do PET, but to await the results from the genetics testing. And I received again a month ago this result from this Euroepinomics study with these severe seizures, not very long, but in cluster appearing many times per day during some days, several days, with some asymmetric depending on the ictal activity on the left or on the right. So the child is severely disturbed, and this September they found by sequencing, whole exome sequencing, SCN8A mutation missense, which is of course pathogenic. This type of mutation in this gene, which is very important for the brain development and functioning, was first described 2 years ago in a child suffering from early onset epileptic encephalopathy in a family which harbored the mutation, but only this girl was symptomatic and died from SUDEP. Then last year a paper appeared summarizing the results of 20 patients already described in the literature, literature, not only having epileptic encephalopathy, but three of them marked with the star, they had only intellectual disability. So again, there is a clinical heterogeneity in the expression of this pathogenic mutation. And this is the last paper published in Epilepsia this July this year. They found 7 mutations, 6 in so-called unclassified severe early onset epileptic encephalopathy, but 1 in a patient with malignant migrating partial seizure of infancy. So they summarized that this mutation or mutation in this gene should be searched in such patient and mostly in unclassified condition, but then also in this malignant syndrome. But we know this syndrome of malignant migrating partial seizures is now listed in this 14th type of early onset epileptic encephalopathy and related, associated to mutation in KC and T1 gene. Also, however, they are patient described harboring KCN1A mutation. So the authors from 2011 emphasized that probably this syndrome is the most severe end of the spectrum of SCN-related epileptic disorders. Of course, something interesting again, this KCNT1 mutation is also implicated in the genesis of autosomal dominant nocturnal frontal lobe epilepsy. So again, we face this pleiotropy of genes and the genetic heterogeneity of one single condition. The usual concept of the epileptic encephalopathy is that ictal and interictal paroxysmal activity can be very, very severe, very aggressive, and during the very important phases of brain maturation is the main factor for the progressive neuropsychological regression in these children. However, as I showed you, there are cases when we face epilepsy, encephalopathy, independent from each other. So probably the causes are related not only to the epilepsy, but per se for the encephalopathy. Or is this term epileptic encephalopathy the right one? So this is again the slide from Sarah. And for us clinicians, the big issue is that many of this type, epilepsy type, are so overlapping that it's very difficult usually to put it in a specific category. And we need, of course, sometime algorithm what to do in such early onset genetic or genetic metabolic encephalopathy. There is such an algorithm in the paper from 2012 by the Italian colleagues. We can see how we need to proceed when we face such patients and what to do. You can find it them. And this is a recent review of Samuel Berkovich in Neurology Nature about the hidden genetic of epilepsy. What is clinically relevant for us? Of course, we know there are many genetic testing already available, the CGH array for copy number variation, the whole exome sequencing, which is still difficult and expensive, karyotyping in some patients when we suspect, for example, ring chromosome 20, but also the development of gene panel evaluation, Sequencing in already known mutation, as I showed you, about 20 to 25 gene related to early onset epileptic encephalopathy. So we can go this way, and this way showed us that in the last 30 years, there is a new paradigm about the etiology of epilepsy. Those conditions we called previously idiopathic now seems to be more clear. Some of them have focal epilepsy, have MRI abnormality. They can be cured in some cases, most of them probably by epilepsy surgery. There is a new group of autoimmune epilepsy, which is very interesting and also promising in some cases in which we can help. But still there are remaining group in which we more and more often face many genetic factor underlying single gene epilepsies with de novo or familial mutation, depending also on the influence of genetic modifiers and susceptibility genes, or the more complex epilepsy with complex inheritance. So the way is difficult, our task is difficult, but very interesting, challenging, and promising. Thank you for the attention.